Broadcom business in North and East region. Thanks.
Hi, good afternoon. I'm Anurup Gupta. I'm the country manager for Broadcom, and basically we take care of the entire networking portfolio of Broadcom and Intel.
Good afternoon. My name is Deep Roy. I'm with Dell EMC, part Dell Technologies, and I look after pre-sales for the Bomb Day Center team.
Namaskar, good afternoon. My name is Santalan Chave. I am working with Government of Delhi, Department of Information Technology. I look after the e-governance initiative of the government. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I am Karnan Pankaj Dikshit. I am working with GSTN, Goods and Services Tax Network, as the Senior Vice President for IT, as well as the Program Manager for the entire GST Services project.
Thank you, sir. So before we start, I'd like to put up a general question. Since from the government side itself, and GSTN being one of the primary, you know, drivers of IT and service delivery in the country, which is very critical, in fact. So, would you like to know your views on the same, what we were discussing, you know, regarding the infrastructure which is available and the type of which you would like to see with low latency, which we have been discussing.
Okay. So, I'll just give a quick overview of what we have for the GST network. We have, you know, we don't have cloud. We have our captive infrastructure. Four data centers we've got. Two are the main data centers, as is normal. And we have near DCs also with each of the data centers. We have more than 400 servers, that is the hosts, physical hosts. And of course, they are the dockers and containers that run on them using Red Hat. We have storage from the standard OEMs. And we have the brocade switches also. And we have the web interface. And we run this entire GST system as a portal. Right? The concept is that it should be a portal available to taxpayers throughout. Our portal works as a single interface for the entire indirect tax collection of the country, whether it is center or the states. So as you know, 17 taxes got subsumed into a single GST, goods and services tax. So the entire tax collection for all these taxes across the country for center and states happens through our portal. There is no other mechanism. So the entire indirect tax revenue figures which you get from the Ministry of Revenue every month, they go through our portal. Except for the customs part and maybe a few taxes which the states are getting to run. In addition to that, we have now managed the growth of taxpayers. We started with about 63 lakhs, that is about from the earlier regime, and then the new registration started from July 2017. Now we have clocked almost 1.2 crore, so almost 100% growth we are about to hit after just about 15, 16 months from when we started. The revenue collection has been steady, and the taxpayer growth is now taking off. And in addition, we've recently launched that MSME facilitation of loans. Then in case your returns are on time and you have a certain turnover, you can get some basis your size of your company, you can get pre-approved loan from the government. So the there were hiccups in the beginning, but I must say the infrastructure held out. And held out very well. Our capacity utilization as of now on peak days might spike to about 60-70%, but on an average is still about 50-20%. So there have been those glitches which you, which taxpayers, from the business community might have experienced, but those have been mainly related to, you know, fine tuning of the applications and the workflows as relates your invoice uploads, getting the returns, confirmation from the databases and those kind of things. It's not been a capacity bottleneck, it's been a more of an application and a workflow bottleneck. And even those are constantly improving. As we learn the twists and turns, we are able to negotiate them better. And as you've seen any announcement in the last couple of days. The new revenue secretary has taken over and he's announced that a simplified or the modified return, which will help the businesses better, will roll out in the month of April. So happy to say that the infrastructure is held out and we've had a good experience as far as that is concerned. And storage also is just about 20-30%. But it will keep growing as we go back. And improvements, what we've learned today from David's talk and from Sumit's talk, these we already have in mind, but we don't have right now an urgency to go for that. But of course, these are natural improvements which will happen once we hit a capacity threshold, which we will, like I said, we don't have defined that threshold right now. But then when we do that, we'll have to upgrade the latest technologies. So in case you don't want to upgrade the infra, but you need to just upgrade the technology, maybe you can keep the same boxes, but by upgrade of technology, you can still hit a higher capacity for you know, your users. Thank you.
Data is increasing and applications are demanding. I had posed that question earlier also, but I would like to hear from you actually your experience. Like, what do you see forward of the growth in data and the infrastructure involved in changing or delivery of data as well as storage of data? Like, how do you see that, sir?
Very interesting thing is that now 16 is getting smart. And citizens is getting smart, government has to work manifold. Okay. So they are demanding various services. We are giving various services online. Around 200 services we are giving online right now. And they will increase to 400 to 500 services very soon. Because that EBJ is coming, e-shopping business is also coming. So lots of services we are going to provide to the citizen in next 1 year. Right now Delhi has no data center, we have subsumed our data center with Government of India data center because we are very nearby. I can see the data center of Government of India just my building only.
Okay, the Nixi one?
Nixi, right. There is a need to have some more infrastructure around, to have business continuity. We have to have near data centers also. And the main challenge in the government what we face, and I think everybody is facing, is the scalability. With the VMs coming now, we are not purchasing servers. We are mainly going for VMs only. So server side, we had our Lakshminarayana data center where we had around 60 to 70 servers, physical servers. Now these servers has with its own lifetime will go down and VM will come. So we are now getting everything on virtualization and on VM only. Now challenge is increasing data. Data is increasing manifold and with the Wi-Fi and IoTs and sensors what we are doing right now, lots of data will be generated because now we are also getting citizens' feedback. So all the feedback of the citizen is going to be in our servers. Right? So that processing is analytics, it's a storage will be a challenge, and I will say challenge in terms that you have to scale up. Right? This is one side of the point. Second side is that we have our own rules, financial rules. So our balancing, we want storage or speed on fly. So telecom is the fiber, we can get speed anytime. But in case of VMs and server, we have to follow certain processes. Right? This process, balancing between processes and our need is to be seen how we match these two things.
Okay. There is one question specific on that. Like, since you know the background and you have a good experience in data, which data center technology do you see coming up or be most suitable for diverse applications like GST and delivery of these services?
Sure. So, before I get into that, right, we were talking about the explosion of data which is happening. And just to give a perspective, we all know that all the social media, IoT, all those things, and the kind of data is getting generated. Basically, today, if you see, most of the data centers, and even the government data centers, were most of them were designed somewhere around 2009, 2010, right? That time,
time, the data volume was very low. If you actually go and see the research, what are the research institutes and is saying, the most of the data has got generated in the last 2 years. 90% of the world data has got generated in the last 2 years. Okay. Now, if I this is actually on a global basis, but and they are talking about by 2020, 2021, they are talking about the data reaching, digital data reaching around 40-50 zettabytes, right? Which is, and right now we are just around 6-7 zettabytes. So if you see that kind of a scale, it's very frightening. Because right now, the data centers obviously are not really designed for that kind of a magnitude. And that is why if you see all the technology that we have been talking about right now, these are, it's a necessity. It is not that it is a must have. It is a must have. It is not a good to have, right? And that is why all these innovations like all flash, like you talk about technology, so all flash. All flash around 3 years back, 2-3 years back, everybody thought that it could just be a fad, it could be a passing fad, right? Today, anybody and everybody who's buying storage is buying all flash. That is the first thing, right? So, the next step, as you said, is can be NVMe over FC. That we have just, it is just about being launched. So we definitely see a lot of momentum coming in the next 2-3 years on NVMe over FC. And obviously, to keep with that trend, Brocade also has been doing our innovation, right? So in the past, when I talk about the 2010 time, it was just used as a sandwich, was just a port connectivity. But today, it is much more than that. So we have a lot of intelligence built in our ASICs, right? We give automation and all the stuff that David and Sumit spoke about. That is because of the fact that we want it to scale. We know that the application will be scaling, right? They'll be demanding more and more power. And that is why we also need to be ready for the future.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'd like to ask one more question to me, especially. We're talking about NVMEs and all architecture. Keeping in mind the cost benefit ratio, and particularly in India, we're very, cost, we are there's a reluctance. How do you see the benefit actually coming more into this technology, by spending more in this? How does the government benefit as far as the cost savings are concerned?
That's a great question. In fact, I'd like to address it in a couple of different ways. One is when we talked about NVMe as a protocol and the fact that it's clearly there as a technology of the future, it's when you look at it as a super highway. Now, obviously, to get there, the way technology has evolved and we move, as was mentioned in one of the earlier sessions, and all flash has actually come on the scene as well. Now, if you see how flash as a technology has been adopted in the past, maybe over a decade back when we introduced flash for the first time, it was a smattering of flash that we gave in the storage area. And then we were trying to figure out what's the best way to optimize because it was the most expensive component in the storage. Then we've moved about a decade and that has become all flash right now pretty much. Virtually everybody is looking at all flash storage. But the protocol from a backend perspective, connectivity of the storage to those to the SSDs is still being SAS, the fundamental protocol. We move from fiber channel to SAS. When we look at NVMe as a protocol, fundamentally the advantages that it has is it's literally a superhighway. I'll give you an analogy. It's like you have a swimming pool available to you, and that's the pool of SSDs. Today, you're sucking out performance with a straw. So you're not able to leverage the kind of performance that pool is capable of. What NVMe as a protocol will do is, it will allow you to have, to extend the crude analogy further, multiple such straws to let you, suck it out a lot faster. But where the utility will really make a difference will be when you move from the media of flash, which is, let's say, starting from SLC, TLC, wherever you've got to, 3D NAND, etc., to when you move to storage class memory. And so we're still a while away from that. So when storage class memory comes on the scene, that will then be the fastest component in the storage array. And flash, which we're looking at now, which was the fastest about a decade back, will actually end up being the slowest component there. Mm-hmm. So the bottleneck has shifted. Anurup pointed out something very interesting, that there is a fabric component that was looked at in a very different way, let's say a decade back. Today it's a very key component, and to ensure that is not a bottleneck in the path. Actually, since the storage, the disk media at the back end was the bottleneck, now the bottleneck is shifting to the controller. So it's not just about implementing something like NVMe. It's about whether the entire infrastructure of the storage and the fabric connectivity, etc., can all take advantage. Coming to the second question, cost.
actually to arrive and deliver the, derive the benefits of NVMe, it's important to look at whether the controller power that is being leveraged needs that kind of throughput at the back. There will always be the 5 or 7 or 10% or outliers which will really demand extremely high performance, extremely low, ridiculously low latencies. NVMe is a great technology for those applications in that kind of workload. But for the vast majority, you know, SSDs with SAS protocol connectivity can typically be found. So as the organizations move to all flash, we will typically look at only a few corner cases specifically where NVMe will come. In a matter of time, it is bound to become the technology of the future. So it will be a transition is how we are seeing. We are willing to embrace that. We have technologies across the board which offer this. Ultimately, it's up to what makes sense to the customer. It's not about us trying to propose a technology and say that's really the answer. So it's about what kind of applications work.
Okay. Sanjay, I would like to pose one question to you. Since you know, we have a very limited space in data centers, typically government, expanding that physical space to something bigger than that is a very big concern. I mean, it usually doesn't happen. There's a lot of time gets wasted on that, you know, constructing a new building. How is the adoption of new technologies going to reduce our dependency on space? Is it going to take more space? Is it going to take less space? That's one concern.
Okay, I mean, this is the least thought. Mostly when the infrastructure is being planned, people have this at the last moment. They think about this at the last moment. See, I mean, it's not only space, there are two other important aspects. One is power and cooling also. Power, I mean, if you look at the rates nowadays, I mean, it is humongous. I mean, that the cost is power and cooling, it goes hand in hand. If you are generating more power, the heat is generated, and you need more BTUs of cooling in that space. So specifically coming to the space, the new technologies are coming with the smaller form factors. You talk about we used to have 5.5-inch disk drive at one point, spinning disk at one point in time. Now, after that, we came with the SAS to 3.5. Now we're coming with the flash, which is still, I mean, small in size. So the new infrastructure is taking care of that. But at the same time, it is more of other two aspects that one needs to look at, because it's not only the space that pushes you to move your data center. You will find other two aspects also. Keeping in mind that, okay, Haryana, the power rates are slightly lower, or maybe UP, the power rates are slightly lower, I'll move my data center to that space or to some other remote space. So those two aspects are very important also. If you look at the technologies which Broadcom offers, I mean, you talk about less than 4 watts, 0.4 watts of power consumption per core. So we started with 0.7, and every generation, the power consumption is reduced further. So that is one of the efficiencies which drive these things.
Okay. That was insightful. I would like to pose a circuit also add in. So looking at the new technology and what we were discussing here, do you see a clear benefit, especially with the GST network, like how would it benefit to you, where the bottlenecks you are facing, and how this is going to help you out? Do you see a clear benefit?
Yeah, so I see a clear benefit in what I have heard today morning about NVMe and how the users will face the improvement. So I'll give you a small use case. What a taxpayer does at the end of the month when he comes and files returns. And I'm talking about a large taxpayer, right? So they have thousands of invoices which they upload onto the system. When they upload two invoices, they are basically in JSON formats. Then they wait for an acknowledgement. So what has to be done is, you upload those invoices, they have to go to the persistence, and then the persistence verifies, does a couple of validations, and then they get an acknowledgement that yes, I have received. Out of 1,000, I have received 900. 100 is an error, and I give you an error report and a confirmation. Thereafter, he comes again, because there was some errors, he comes and uploads again. This happens for all the taxpayers, and the larger the number of invoices you have, the more time you're spending, the more of that latency happens from your uploading it, like going through the flow of validations, persistence, getting an acknowledgement back. Now all this is happening on storage, right? So So in case we can include incorporate efficiencies of IOPS, as Dave was showing in his slides, all this will go to a better UX and better user experience. So like I said, right now we are not, we do have those challenges of the last day, because typically nobody wants to face Dexter before the last day. So we have the complete, the complete load of the system comes on in the last day. Now the question is, do you want to spend so much of money just for one day's of efficiency? Because 80% of the time then the infrastructure is lying more or less unutilized. But at some point of time we will have to take, because when the text space increase and go beyond a certain stage, we want to reduce the latencies as we go forward. We have to come to that decision point that now we have to upgrade. So obviously we do see efficiencies happening from the technology that we just heard about.
Okay, very fine. I agree with you. In our train tech department, same thing happened before GST and VAT last week. Entire load was there and server is to crash and everything. Now we have handled that thing. But yes, in another perspective, I agree that our latency and our entire process speed and ultimately what you said, user experience is very important, which is to be taken care of. And obviously these technologies what you told today, definitely they are the base to use them. But again, same thing, in the government processes are very important. We have to define first what we want, how we want. Then this process, like you could talk about cost. Cost is a very important factor when I say that this kind of quality I want, and when I have a competition, then there should be a sufficient number of the players who have this, and then we go for cost. So cost is a very important factor in the government, because it's the public money. And obviously, after setting up my own standards, that is what I want, cost comes. So in that, we should have a segment where people are available and they are, there is a competition overall to give same quality in good cost.
So, to any of the technology guys, we are talking about storage technology and networks. What's the correlation and how does it impact each other?
Part of it I was trying to address in my earlier point, and I think you touched a very key point. So in the industry, we have a phenomena which I would call hurry up and wait. What it means is, let's say you're waiting at a traffic light, and you just wait for it to zip through, and then you rush through, but since it's not synchronized, all that happens is you end up with the next bottleneck at the next traffic light in front of you. So the problem is the bottleneck moves to the place where you have maximum congestion. David mentioned about the roundabout phenomena in India. It's an interesting analogy. I can literally see that on my way to the forum here today. But I think the comment that I make here is the two are inseparable. And if you end up with a choke point at the fabric, for example, this is a comment that was made in one of the sessions as well. People tend to ignore the fabric when they do a storage application. Not everyone, but a large number of people. Now, the fabric was purchased at some point in time when the infrastructure was set up. And then the infrastructure was upgraded. And the fabric was considered the least important. So what happens is you're running day before yesterday's fabric infrastructure, and you're looking at today's or even tomorrow's storage at the back end and host bus adapters and stuff. So that becomes a choke. That's one aspect. Second is the storage itself. Now, when I say storage, I don't necessarily mean stuff has to be in a three-tier format. That's the very traditional way that we look at compute, storage, and network segregated in that way. Even if I look at the network, fiber channel part. We're also looking at a lot of things like hyperconverged infrastructure, or in a rack scale kind of thing where you have virtual networking built in as part of that. So CI, HCI kind of technologies and the traditional three-tier architectures. So to look at that, why there's a lot of interest that we've seen from organizations in terms of converged hyperconverged is because the networking part is taken care of, it's optimized. So we don't have a situation where something is out of sync with another. And even patches and release certifications work in tandem with each other. But even if we look at traditional networks, I think my viewpoint would be that we have to ensure that we don't have a bottleneck, that we don't look at components which will create a choke, and we are having to look at upgradation. The entire thing needs to be upgraded as well. So you need to have the protocols, you need to have the backend drive connectivity. The controller shouldn't be a choke. fabric should be made, so interconnect between them should be. So it requires all of these carefully thought out and brought in together when you do the competition.
Adding to what Deep said, right, we've also seen this practically. So right now we're talking about the FCA with NVMe and 32 gig connectivity and all, right? So, but one question which comes to us very often is that my storage or server is still 16 gig or 8 gig, right? And why do I need a 32 gig switch? So we have done that, we had done a third party analysis on that. And it has been found out that even if you change the switch, right, so it's a 8 gig connectivity on the both ends, but if you have a 32 gig switch, your response time actually goes on by 75%. So your query, the number of queries that can be processed goes up by 4x. So basically, coming back to your question on how it is correlated, there is a very strong correlation, and that is why the switch does not need to be really treated as a port count only. And there is a much more higher capability than we offer.
Okay.
Okay.
You would like to add something on that?
Yeah, basically, I mean, see, typically from the government perspective, everyone, even in the enterprise world, everyone talks about having the best of breed. I mean, we have RFPs, we have all these evaluations, just to ensure that we pick up the best technology in every aspect, be it servers, be it network, be it application, we take the best out of breed product. So, least is given importance, and most of talk about the SAN switching, the fabric. Because if you look at the predominant data movement happens between the server, this specific SAN network, which is our brocade switching, and the storage. So entire data path has to be managed. If one part is lagging, there will be a choke, there will be an issue on that movement, data movement. So you have to take care of on the server front also, on the SAN switching front also, and on the storage front also. So that is the gradual path, the clean path.
Could you just give us some insight around HCI if you and its potential for users, especially in the organization?
Yes. Yeah. See, there are a lot of technologies which have been involved in over a period of time. I mean, one size doesn't fit all. So I won't say that it's a technology that one shouldn't look at. You shouldn't evaluate it. But there are certain applications where it fits the bill. I mean, you can't have it for an enterprise application. You can't run a GSTN sort of setup or UIDA sort of setup on an HCI platform. But yeah, if it is a VDI sort of application, go for it. I mean, there should be no problem. Yeah. But you have to choose the thing. That's what I'm saying. You have to use the best of breed products. So specific applications, specific technologies are fit for certain sizes. The size A, size B, size C. You don't have to mismatch those sizes. I mean, you have to be very particular about what is your, basically, the final outcome, what the final outcome has to be. Which, if it's an enterprise data center, don't think about that. Yeah, for a smaller HCI sort of setup, go for it, there's no problem.
Okay. So, one more question.
Just wanted to add a little bit to what Sanjay said. So, see, basically, HCI, obviously, everybody is talking about it. And it is an evolving technology, no doubt about it. There are certain spaces where it will reside, okay, but as far as the mission critical applications are concerned, we still see all of them being deployed on SAN. We have not seen customers moving out yet. And one of the reasons is, apart from whatever the technology offering, one of the reasons is, I would assume, security. Security is one of the biggest reasons for any of the organizations, right? One of the biggest concerns. And when did you last time hear a SAN network being hacked? Never, I guess never. Why? You talk about the SCSI network, maybe IP network, maybe yesterday night somewhere, right? So obviously, if you look at all those aspects, storage networking is the only purpose-built technology for storage.
So one more question, do you think that FC is the right fabric for MVMs?
Sorry?
FC is the right fabric for MVMs?
Well, yes.
Like that's an opinion, like, you know, they go to
coming from Brookgate, yes, definitely. I cannot talk sure. about anything else. So.
Okay.
And all the tests, everything have been done on a
so video. So we have to be neutral also.
It's being tested on both the platforms, right? But if you talk about FCO or NVMe, we already have a full-fledged storage boxes out. Dell is one of the vendors who have already rolled it out, right? And you have an entire end-to-end available on FCO or NVMe. So and the performance and all has been also very good. So again, for the mission-critical application, we still see it going the FCO or NVMe or NVMe.
Okay, sir.
Can I add something in here?
Yeah,
sure.
Please, sir.
I'll take a mic. I can't stop myself. not talking. So great questions. I was just paying a lot of attention into there. Couple of things I'd like to add here. So is FC the right technology? Yes, it is. Right? Because that's the only technology. It's been purpose built for storage, right? And we just mentioned that's one thing. Another thing is that. Introducing the new storage in data center is the biggest challenge for a data center manager, right, and a storage manager, right? How flash got introduced in the data center, right? Eventually, what happened that we connect the all flash arrays, right, to the existing network. We did not rip and replace the whole network, right? Ripping and replacing is the biggest challenge. I generally use one analogy. We are all Indians. Right? Our dream is to buy a piece of land and build our own house. Right? So we acquire the land. The second step for us is do the Bhumi Puja. And the third step is what? Having the foundation ready. Foundation is the most critical and most important piece of any architecture. If you have a rock solid foundation, you want to build one floor, two floor, three floor, five floors. You can build on top of it. If your foundation is not supporting multiple floors, you won't be able to scale. That's the same thing is for the fabrics. Because fabrics is the foundation of the whole data center, if you see that. That way. If we are making our investment into that, we have to make sure we are making the right decision into that, number one. And we have to make sure that the fabric is capable of supporting any kind of workload, right? Like he just mentioned. At the end of the month, right, we see a lot of inference coming in into the, you know, the applications are coming in, the, you know, the workload is coming in, right? If we have a right infrastructure, we should not be very involved, right? So that's another factor in there. To the point where, Anurup mentioned, that SAN switches were looked into just for the connectivity, right? And in fact, most of the sales and pre-sales reps who were talking to the customers like them, right, have been asking one question to them in the last 10, 15 years. When you are a customer, you want additional, say, 50 or 100 terabytes, right? They will ask them, sir, how many SAN ports you have or you need a switch,
yeah.
Right? We have been asking those portions in the case of legacy infrastructure. Now when we're talking about all flash, when we're talking about NVMe capable storage, right? We need to ask our customers a different question. Mr. Customer, you are buying a Ferrari. Do you have the infrastructure to run that Ferrari? That's the most important piece, I guess. Yeah. Thank you
for your insight, sir. And we'd like to ask if there's any question of our guest.
I can move the mic. There is any question?
I think all of us are moving now, I think. That is an issue. Are we in time now? So, we'd like to conclude them. If there is any question, we'd like to pick. Anything else, sir? You would like to add anything? If anybody would like to add anything on this? So we conclude the session. Okay. Thank you all for being, and it was quite insightful to gain knowledge, and especially, you know.